Yeah, we'll start off the second topic, that is amenorrhea. So what is primary amenorrhea? What is definition of primary amenorrhea? So when do you want to investigate a case? Suppose a patient with 13 years will come. Her mother will get her. Madam, normally by 14 years all her colleagues got periods, she is not getting. Please check her problem. You want to investigate? When do you want to wait until what age you ask her to come back? This is the most common problem. It is not very rare. So automatically the mothers will get stressed once she will not attend period by 15 years. So maximum time they can wait is only 15 years. By the 15th year the mother will get her the child. So until how many years you want to wait? What is definition of amenorrhea? What is definition of amenorrhea? So a patient, she has not attained period by 16 years, but absence of menses by age 16 with normal growth and secondary sexual characters. So if the patient is having normal secondary sexual characters, means what characters? Normal breast development, normal axillary hair, normal pubic hair development. Okay. So if the patient is having all the secondary sexual characters, but the patient is not having menses, her age is 16 years, then investigate. Suppose if the patient is having no secondary sexual characters, no breast development and all, no axillary hair, no pubic hair. So in such a case, investigate the patient by the age of 14 years. Okay, the definition was asked for you. When do you call a patient as amenorrhea? 16 years with secondary sexual characters, 14 years without secondary sexual characters. So what is the most, how many types are there? How many types of amenorrhea? Primary and secondary. Most common cause of primary we have discussed is gonadal dysgenesis. Coming to secondary amenorrhea. So what is the definition of, when do you call patient as secondary amenorrhea? 6 months. So previously she was having periods, but since 6 months she is having no periods. So call, we can call such a patient as secondary. So absence of menses for greater than 6 months. So what is the most common cause of secondary amenorrhea? Pregnancy. If the pregnancy is not there in option, which is next most common cause of secondary? PCOD. So nowadays it is PCOD. First is pregnancy. Patient is not there, then pregnancy is not there, then go for PCOD. So this is what we have discussed, the very important chart. And if you don't understand now whatever the hormones or whatever the cause of amenorrhea, once you read your books you can never understand. So once I am teaching you, if you are having any doubts, now itself clear it off. Okay, after the class. Now itself means not in between, after the class. So a patient presents with amenorrhea, either primary amenorrhea or secondary amenorrhea. So now what is normal menstrual cycle? How it is regulated? What is the axis called as? So it is called as hypothalamo pituitary ovarian axis. Ovary is going to act on where? Ovarian hormones are going to act on uterus. So finally the patient is going to have menses. So if the patient is not having periods, means the defect can be at the uterus level, the defect can be at the uterus level, the defect can be at ovarian level, pituitary or hypothalamus. So that's how we have divided it into four compartments. We called as compartments. Either it can be defect at any of these compartments. So a patient came with amenorrhea. Today a patient came with amenorrhea, I told you. So hirsutism with amenorrhea. So amenorrhea, now what do you do? First, either primary amenorrhea or secondary amenorrhea. How do you investigate? Primary, I'll tell you. First, I'll teach off this chart, then I'll go to primary amenorrhea. So a patient, especially PCOD, most commonly primary amenorrhea we see rarely. We have seen cases of primary amenorrhea. I have seen testicular feminization syndromes and all. But the secondary amenorrhea is more common rather than primary amenorrhea. So how to investigate a case of secondary amenorrhea? First thing is, the patient is not having any periods. So I give progesterone tablet. Progesterone tablet, that is medroxyprogesterone acetate 10 mg I have given. So I have given her progesterone tablet. After taking tablets for 5 days, the patient had periods. First thing, the patient had periods. Now tell me, what is the cause? So the patient is having defective progesterone. Okay, estrogen is there, continuously estrogen is there, but there is no progesterone. This condition we see specifically in case of PCOS. Okay, so on giving progesterone, automatically the patient had periods. Means her hypothalamus is okay, pituitary is okay, ovarian axis is okay, but some defect at the level of secretion of the progesterone. So once I gave progesterone, she had periods. So now I should supplement. I should mainly the progesterone deficiency seen in case of PCOD patients. So rule out diagnosis of PCOD and give treatment progesterone tablets for every cycle in the second half. This is the treatment. So I gave progesterone. I have seen even many patients. So after progesterone, she come back after 1 week. I asked her to wait for 1 week to 10 days. She came, madam, 1 week finished, 10 days finished, today is already 12th day, but I am not having any periods. So whatever the tablet you gave, it is not working. So now what I should do? Amenorrhea, secondary amenorrhea. I am speaking about the secondary amenorrhea, total topic is. So there is progesterone. So automatically along with progesterone, I also supplemented estrogen, that is OC pill. Okay? Along with progesterone, I also added estrogen. So now two types. Either the patient can have bleeding or patient cannot have bleeding. Once supplementing the progesterone and estrogen, the patient cannot have bleeding or patient can have bleeding. Okay? So the patient is not having bleeding even with hormones. Normally, whatever the uterus, it is going to acted by two hormones. So estrogen and progesterone. So either they are secreted. So from here GnRH and LH, from to here FSH and LH, from here estrogen and progesterone. So they are going to act directly on the ovaries. So this is how the normal cycle. But whatever the estrogen and progesterone, I have given supplemental estrogen and progesterone. But still the patient is not having bleeding. Now tell me, where is the defect? Uterus. Because I have supplemented estrogen and progesterone, but the patient is not having bleeding, means there is some defect at the uterus. So any outflow tract obstruction. Marker inkotundandi. It's ante sariga raayatledu kindiki vache sariki. Idi kuda ante cut aitundi sari chuddu. So coming to uterus, here it is outflow tract obstruction. So even I have supplemented estrogen and progesterone, there is still no bleeding. Okay? So even after supplying uterus estrogen and progesterone, means there can be any adhesions inside the uterus, or there can be what all the outflow tract obstruction causes mainly is, it is adhesions, it is Asherman syndrome. So once you give even estrogen and progesterone, it cannot work because totally adhered, or there can be cervical stenosis. So stenosis is there. So what is happening in cervical stenosis? Blood is collecting, but it is not coming out. So there can be even cervical stenosis. So it is outflow tract obstruction. So even after estrogen and progesterone, the patient comes back after 10 days. Doctor, I have taken, sorry, not 10 days, estrogen and progesterone will give it for 1 month. Okay. I'll ask her, the patient, to take OC pill for 1 month course. After that, I'll ask her to come back. Doctor, I have taken even OC pill. Today is my 21 days OC pills. Normally today is my 10th day. So today is almost 31. Still I am not have bleeding. So if patient presents like that, check her outflow tract obstruction. So any defect at the uterus level, cervix or vagina level. Okay. Suppose a patient had bleeding with progesterone and estrogen. So now what does it indicate? So estrogen is not producing properly. Okay. So the defect can be at the level of the ovary or hypothalamus or pituitary. So these three, the defect can lie at any point. Now I should rule out ovarian cause, hypothalamus and pituitary. So how I will rule out? I will do very two important tests, FSH and LH and estrogen, estradiol levels. So estradiol levels, okay. Suppose if the ovary is functioning, now tell me what is going to happen to estrogen if the ovary is functioning. It is okay, ovary, estradiol. So normal estrogen, so this is the axis. This is estrogen is going to have pituitary inhibitory effect or not? Previously we have discussed. So it is going to inhibit. So if in a case of ovary, there will be estrogen levels will be normal. Now tell me FSH and LH, what is going to happen? If the ovary is normal, estrogen levels are normal, what is going to happen to FSH and LH? Decrease. Yeah, very good. Because negative feedback we have seen. So normally in a menstrual cycle, once estrogen is there, it is going to inhibit. So FSH and LH levels will decrease. Now tell me if it is an hypothalamic cause or pituitary cause, what is going to happen to FSH and LH? FSH and LH, if it is hypopituitary cause, what is going to happen? Decrease. So, from where the FSH and LH is secreted? Pituitary. So, if there is a defect at the pituitary, FSH and LH will decrease. So, in a pituitary region, FSH and LH decreased estrogen. No, one second. So, if it is a pituitary cause, the FSH, ovarian cause, decreased estrogen. So, increased FSH and LH. If it is a ovarian cause, decreased estrogen. So, if there is a cause at the ovary level, so, if the ovary is not functioning, is there enough estrogen or not? Ovary is not functioning. So, there is decreased estrogen. So, decreased estrogen, what it is going to do? Stimulate or inhibit? Stimulate. So, increased FSH and LH. Yeah, whereas hypothalamus and pituitary regions, the pituitary is not secreting FSH and LH. What is going to happen to FSH and LH? So, that is how I decide. So, I do very two important tests, FSH and LH. So, if the FSH and LH are increased, it is ovarian cause. If the FSH and LH are decreased, it is either hypothalamus or pituitary causes. What is most common cause pituitary? Where do we see? Which pituitary will cause this decreased amenorrhea? Which pituitary cause? Prolactinomas, mostly prolactinomas. So, prolactinoma, two types, microadenoma, macroadenoma. So, two types are there in prolactinomas. What other pituitary cause we have discussed until now? What other pituitary cause can have amenorrhea after delivery? Sheehan syndrome. So, that is one more pituitary cause. What is Sheehan syndrome? Necrosis because of severe postpartum hemorrhage. So, automatically the blood supply to the pituitary is going to get reduced. So, there will be ischemic necrosis of the pituitary. So, this is very important. They have asked which are all the features of the Sheehan syndrome. So, a patient with Sheehan syndrome can have decreased thyroid level. Whatever the pituitary hormones, they are all going to get reduced. So, decreased FSH, decreased LH, decreased thyroid, decreased prolactin levels. So, a patient can have failure of lactation. After delivery, there will be failure of lactation. And skin pigmentation, ACTH, even the ACTH levels are also reduced. So, there will be excess skin pigmentation of the patient. So, you need to replace with all these hormones. So, which of the following is not used in the replacement of the Sheehan syndrome? So, you are giving thyroid, you are giving FSH and LH, you are giving ACTH. So, that is the management. Is it clear this chart? Now, you know how to investigate a case, okay? Patient with secondary amenorrhea. So, if it is FSH and LH, then we decide either ovarian cause. Suppose if it is a pituitary cause, we go for MRI. Okay, MRI we can see adenomas and serum prolactin levels. So, this is how we investigate. We will go on to further. So, initial test for amenorrhea. Suppose a patient came with amenorrhea. So, what test you want to write? Initial, the three basic tests. So, the three basic tests what I will do is, the patient today I have discussed, I told you PCOD patient. So, she came around 1 week back. So, I wrote three baseline tests. First thing is thyroid. Second thing is prolactin levels. So, prolactin is not such rare. Don't think it is a very rare condition. I got a case from medicine referral, same hospital. So, the patient was having hirsutism and amenorrhea features. So, baseline test, any patient with baseline is first go for thyroid and prolactin. Her prolactin levels were around 325. What should be the normal prolactin level? Less than 20. So, if it is greater than 100, it is macroadenoma. There are two adenomas, pituitary prolactinoma. One is microadenoma, one is macroadenoma. So, the patient was having 325 macroadenoma of the pituitary. The best investigation next, how can I diagnose pituitary macroadenoma is MRI. Okay, that is how. So, the first go for baseline. Normally, patient may not have much features of prolactin. So, other features, what other features a prolactin hyperprolactinemia can present with? What features a patient can present with? Other than amenorrhea? Galacturia. The patient can have galacturia, but I have not seen galacturia in many cases. So, any patient with amenorrhea first to do thyroid levels. So, thyroid is very common hypothyroidism. Second thing is prolactin, either elevated prolactin levels or normal prolactin levels. So after this, I am going to check if the both TSH and prolactin were normal in that patient. So whatever the patient has come. So I gave progesterone challenge test to the young female. So she got bleeding. Now what is the diagnosis? Positive progesterone challenge test. What is the diagnosis? PCOD. So I confirmed it with once again FSH LH ratio and ultrasound scan. So it confirmed my diagnosis. Sometimes both it will be seen. Hypo and normally what they say is hyper they have opposite. They have amenorrhea and hypo they have menorrhagia. But both conditions it can be seen. It is not like a hard and fast rule like only in hypo they should present like this. Hyper they should present like this. అది కూడా ఇచ్చింటాడు సర్జరీలో కింద. సో ప్రొజెస్టాన్ ఛాలెంజ్ టెస్ట్. సో వన్స్ ప్రొజెస్టాన్ ఛాలెంజ్ టెస్ట్ పాజిటివ్ టెస్ట్ మీన్స్ పేషెంట్ ఈస్ హ్యావింగ్ విత్డ్రాయల్ నార్మల్ ప్రొలాక్టిన్ నార్మల్ టీఎస్హెచ్. సో వాట్ ద కేస్ సినారియో ఐ హావ్ డిస్కస్. సో నౌ వాట్ ఈస్ ద డయాగ్నోసిస్? అనోవులేషన్. ద పేషెంట్ ఈస్ నాట్ సెక్రెటింగ్. సో ప్రొజెస్టాన్ ఇస్ నాట్ సెక్రెటెడ్. సో పీసీఓడి. మోస్ట్ ఆఫ్ ద టైమ్స్ ద కాస్ ఇస్ పీసీఓడి. ట్రీట్మెంట్ ఈస్ మంత్లీ ప్రొజెస్టాన్ ట్రీట్మెంట్ ఆఫ్ పీసీఓడి ట్రీట్మెంట్. So this we have, this you know I don't want to confuse you with you. Is this chart clear? Any doubts in this chart? I am skipping this slide. Nothing but the same whatever we have discussed. So the question whatever in the book says it is very clear. So they didn't give you how do you, some questions are based on like this. So a patient you give positive progesterone challenge test. So patient developed amenorrhea, came with amenorrhea, positive progesterone challenge test. What is the diagnosis? In few cases. There is hypothalamic. I will tell you what is hypogonadism. What is hypogonadism? Hypothalamic and all causes. So in few cases they gave like this. So if patient came to you with amenorrhea, breast is absent. So no breast. They can ask you either breast or they can ask you secondary sexual characters. So the breast is absent in that patient, but the uterus is present. Now what do you think? Secondary. There are no secondary sexual characters, but genitalia are there. Typical questions. These are typical questions asked in AIIMS and All India. There are four case scenarios. First thing is breast is absent, uterus is present. Second scenario we'll discuss reverse. Breast is present, uterus is absent. Third case scenario is breast is absent, uterus is absent. So three case scenarios. Four is breast is present, uterus is present, but patient is having amenorrhea. So four case scenarios today we are going to discuss. So in the question says if the patient is having absent breast but there is uterus present, so what are all the conditions? What are all the conditions? Where can we see the normal uterus but with absent breast? Why? First tell me why the breast is developed. Estrogen. So now we came to know that breast development is only one because main hormone is estrogen. So in such cases, does uterus want estrogen to develop? What does uterus develop from which organ? Uterus is developing from duct. What duct? Paramesonephric, otherwise called as Mullerian duct. So if there is defect in the duct, there will not be uterus. Whereas breast is no duct, it is totally dependent upon the estrogen. So in such cases we know there is no estrogen. So now which conditions there are no estrogen? Normally which from where the estrogen is produced? Ovary. So which patients will not have ovary? Gonadal dysgenesis, very most common. What is the most common gonadal dysgenesis? Turner's. What is the chromosomal karyotyping? Turner's 45XO. What all other gonadal dysgenesis? What is pure gonadal dysgenesis? What is the karyotype of pure gonadal dysgenesis? Pure. What is pure gonadal dysgenesis? What is Swyer's syndrome? Did you hear Swyer's syndrome? So there are three types of gonadal dysgenesis. So in gonadal dysgenesis, either it can be XO, that is Turner's, or XX or XY. Okay. So if it is XO, it is Turner's. If it is XX, it is pure gonadal dysgenesis. If it is 46XY, it is Swyer's syndrome. Okay. These are all the three types of gonadal dysgenesis. So now you know if a question asks you there is no breast and uterus present, first cause to think about is mostly gonadal dysgenesis. Out of gonadal dysgenesis, most common is Turner's. Now we'll see what are all the other causes. So patient without breast and with a uterus indicate what? They have no ovarian estrogen. So ovaries are not developed. In Turner's, what type of ovaries? Streak gonads. So streak gonads will be seen. So the gonadal dysgenesis. So there are two types: hypergonadotrophic, hypogonadism. Here in ovarian cause we are seeing. So it is the when coming to primary amenorrhea, it is the most common cause of primary amenorrhea. So if the FSH and LH is decreased, as a result there is amenorrhea. It is called as hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. Okay, because FSH is decreased, LH is decreased, as a result there is decreased estrogen. So no more development. Whereas a case of increased estrogen but decreased FSH and LH in pituitary cause, hypergonadotrophic, because increased estrogen is seen. Okay, whereas FSH and LH are altered. So any ovarian causes means ovary, any ovarian pathology, if it is there, why ovarian pathology increased, decreased estrogen, what is going to cause? Why we are calling hypergonadotrophic and hypogonadotrophic is, if there is increased FSH and LH, we call it as hypergonadotrophic. If there is decreased FSH and LH, we call it as hypogonadotrophic. Is it clear? So simple. So a patient with increased ovarian cause, what we have seen in any ovarian pathology, decreased estrogen, so increased FSH and LH. So once the FSH and LH is increased, automatically we are calling it as hypergonadotrophic. So the question can be like this. So a patient with hypergonadotrophic hypogonadism means what is the cause? Where is the cause? Ovary. So which of the following is the cause of the hypergonadotrophic hypogonadism? So the cause is the ovary level. That's why we are calling it as hypergonadotrophic and hypogonadism. It is the most common cause of primary. Gonadal dysgenesis is the most common cause of primary amenorrhea. So it is due to chromosomal deletion or disorder. Normally we see gonadal streak, a band of fibrous tissue. It is not a ovary actually, band of fibrous tissue. Streak ovaries we call it as. So 46XY is Turner, excess is pure gonadal dysgenesis, 46XY is Weyers. So what is main pathology? No follicles, no estrogen production. That's why no breast development. That's why in a case of Turner's there will be no breast development. So now tell me, decreased estrogen, FSH and LH, what is going to happen? Increase. So in such a cases, FSH and LH are markedly elevated because no estrogen, no feedback. Turner's can have such a hormonal profile. But estrogen is not necessary for Müller and duct development. Okay. So automatically the duct will develop. That's why the patient will be having phenotypically female characters. So suppose a patient presented with breast absent, uterus present. How to investigate such a cases? So what are all the investigations? First thing is, do FSH. If FSH is increased, in which conditions FSH is increased? Ovary. So there is decreased estrogen. So there can be gonadal dysgenesis. Ovary is the defect. So how many ovary, once you know it is ovarian cause, go for karyotyping. How many types are there? XO. Okay, either Turner's or XX. XX is pure gonadal. XY is Swayer syndrome. So if a patient presents with XY, phenotypically it is, most of the times, okay, in such a cases, what do we see is XY, almost it is, the ovaries are not developed, okay, but sometimes we can see even the male organs. So go for gonadectomy. In which other condition we go for gonadectomy? Which other condition we do gonadectomy? Congenital anomalies related to this amenorrhea. A patient in which other conditions? We'll see, where do we do gonadectomy. Okay, so this is the cause. How do we evaluate? Suppose if there is decreased FSH, where do we see decreased FSH? Either it can be hypothalamus disorder or pituitary disorder, we don't know, we need to rule out. Weight, exercise and stress, these three are going to act directly on the hypothalamus. Okay, suppose a patient, you can see initially she'll be having normal weights, a patient later she has been shifted to zero size and all, that's why it is very dangerous. Patient can have amenorrhea because it is going to act directly on the hypothalamus. So exercise, any weight or any stress, even you can see sometimes during exams, especially the stress is very high, the periods are altered, the patient will have amenorrhea because at the effect is at the level of the hypothalamus. So the weight, exercise and stress, these are all the hypothalamic causes. And what is this Kallmann syndrome? Otherwise called as Kallmann's. What is this specific feature of Kallmann's? It is called as hypothalamo olfactory syndrome. So this specific feature seen in the Kallmann's is anosmia. Okay, so it can be either Kallmann's syndrome, or not only that, sometimes the cause can be thyroid and prolactin. So initially itself we have discussed, any patient with amenorrhea first do thyroid and prolactin. So if it is hypothyroidism, replace with thyroid, and prolactin go for, if the depending upon the prolactin levels, if it is 20 to 100, it is microadenoma, directly you can put her on drug. What is the drug of choice for prolactinoma? Bromocriptine. Second drug is two drugs, bromocriptine and cabergoline. Suppose if it is a macroadenoma, when do we call macroadenoma? Greater than 100. If the prolactin level is greater than 100, we call it as macroadenoma. What is the treatment for macroadenoma? Surgery. Okay, you are going to do surgery. So if it is a prolactin level, CT or MRI, then depending upon that you can decide what is the cause. So the same thing, thyroid, you are going to give thyroxine, CNS tumor, treat microadenoma or MAC, whatever the thing. So weight, exercise, stress, psychiatric treatment, or whatever the alternative treatment. Kallmann syndrome, I'll tell you in detail. So we are going to give estrogen and progesterone replacement. Whereas gonadal dysgenesis, if it is an XX or XO or XY. So normally XX is associated with 17 alpha hydroxy deficiency also. We need to replace 17 alpha hydroxylase enzyme. I'll tell you what is that 17 alpha hydroxylase deficiency. So if it is an XY, go for gonadectomy, so that she'll be rated totally as a female. Turner's is normally male or female? Female. So most of the gonadal dysgenesis, they should be rated as a female patients. So even XY gonadal dysgenesis, remove the gonads and rate the patient as female, followed by estrogen and progesterone replacement, so that she can develop her normal breast. Any gonadal dysgenesis, give estrogen so that she will get normal breast development and menses, everything. XO in Turner's also we are going to replace whatever the defective is, estrogen. So we are going to replace the estrogen and progesterone. So Turner's syndrome, the typical feature is, if the question says it is primary amenorrhea with absent breasts, so first thing you need to think about is gonadal dysgenesis. So in gonadal dysgenesis, Turner's, what are all the typical features of Turner's? How a patient with Turner's present with short stature, webbed neck, widely spaced nipples, good cubitus valgus, good. Next, what is the most common cardiac disorder? Coarctation of aorta. It is coarctation of aorta. Other than that, what other the Turner's can present with? So the patient can have short stature, webbing of the neck, short fourth metacarpal, cubitus valgus, cardiac abnormality, it is coarctation of aorta, renal abnormalities and associated hypothyroidism. So how do you treat? So the patient is having defective secondary sexual characters. So the breast is not developed. So for secondary sexual characters to be developed, give estrogen therapy replacement. So estrogen progesterone will have, she will have her normal cycles, at the same time development of the breast. If she is short, what do you want to give? Growth hormone, further growth. So yeah, this is the typical short stature, low posterior hairline, webbing of the neck, broad chest, white spaced nipples. This is cubitus valgus, streak ovaries, pigmented nevi, another thing. So coming to 17 alpha hydroxylase. So we have seen 17 alpha hydroxylase deficiency. So this enzyme mainly, what is the importance of this enzyme? This enzyme is responsible for synthesis of sex steroids. So normal, if you take the synthesis, so there can be, starting from the cholesterol, everything will come, okay, sex steroids, next even the mineralocorticoid and adrenalocorticoid. So everything comes under one cycle. So if one is blocked, automatically other is raised, okay. So this 17 alpha hydroxylase and 21 alpha hydroxylase, various enzymes are there for various synthesis. The important role of the 17 alpha hydroxylase is, it is going to synthesize the sex steroid. So once this 17 alpha hydroxylase is blocked, specifically it is seen in gonadal dysgenesis 46XX. So patients have decreased cortisol. It is, I think if next time I'll get to the chart, it is a very good chart. If you see it, it can understand. So starting from the cholesterol, normally there are various three types will be there. So one is sex steroids, one is cortisol, and other is androgen production and all. So these are various charts. So 17 alpha hydroxylase is useful for synthesis of both sex steroids and also cortisol. So once this is affected, there is decreased cortisol. At the same time, the patients will have decreased sex steroid production. So decreased ACTH, what it is going to cause? Decreased ACTH, decreased sodium and water retention. So once decreased sodium and water retention, what is going to happen? In normally ACTH, what is going to happen? ACTH will increase sodium or potassium? Decrease it. ACTH normally what it will do? Aldosterone. Aldosterone is going to cause sodium. Sodium and water retention. So a patient with 17 alpha hydroxylase deficient. So a sodium and water retention, what it is going to cause? Sodium retention, it is going to cause hypernatremia. Where do we see hyponatremia? In which condition? Decreased ACTH is seen in which condition? Decreased ACTH. Just now we have discussed. So which of the following is not a feature of, where do we see decreased ACTH levels? Sheehan syndrome, pituitary. So this was asked for you. In a case of Sheehan syndrome, pituitary, there will be not only decreased thyroid and all we have seen. So decreased ACTH, it is seen in Sheehan syndrome. This decreased ACTH, it is going to decrease the sodium and water retention. So there is increased excretion of the sodium. So that is the one typical feature. So in 17 alpha hydroxylase deficiency, due to excess mineralocorticoid, there can be hypertension, hypernatremia and hypokalemia. Normally increased sodium and decreased potassium with any cortisol. So these patients, what we are going to do? We are going to replace with sex steroids and cortisol levels. Suppose normally patients, mostly they can achieve pregnancy with the help of in vitro fertilization. But at the same time, the 17 alpha hydroxylase can occur in 46XX. One more cause is 46XY. So a patient having with 46XY, there will be no even female internal genitalia. So normally 46XX, what we are seeing? Internal genitalia are there, but there is no breast development. Suppose if the patient presented with 46XY, there will not be female internal genitalia. So the uterus is absent, breast is also absent. Okay, 17 alpha hydroxylase comes under two category. One is breast is absent, uterus is present. That's what we have discussed. Whereas 17 alpha hydroxylase with 46XY means no breast, no internal genitalia, no female internal genitalia. Okay, that is regarding the 17. We'll see it once again in uterus absent and breast absent. So hypothalamo pituitary disorders. Hypothalamo pituitary, just now we have seen. So what is going to happen in hypothalamo pituitary disorders? There can be uterus, breast is absent, uterus is present. There is no sufficient estrogen. Why estrogen is not produced? Because the defect is at the level of hypothalamus, specifically seen in the case of weight, stress and all, exercises. So there is low levels of estrogen. Why low levels of estrogen? Due to low gonadotrophins. Especially either they can be anatomical lesions of the hypothalamus. The cause, if it is at the hypothalamus level, either they can be congenital or acquired. Acquired we have already discussed, prolactinomas. Other than prolactinomas, craniopharyngiomas and chromophobe adenomas. Second thing is congenital stenosis, any stenosis and absence of the cellular floor. So these are all the hypothalamic causes which there is decreased production of estrogen due to low gonadotrophin release. Okay. Or else there is other condition where there is inadequate GnRH release. Sometimes the GnRH levels will not be released inadequately, especially in case of Kallmann syndrome sometimes. So there will be inadequate GnRH secretion. In such a condition, for all this, what do you give treatment is supplement with estrogen and progesterone supplementation. So why we are going to give, it is going to develop breast at the same time for epiphyseal closure. For fertility, we can go for even menopausal gonadotrophins. Kallmann syndrome. What is this Kallmann syndrome? Kallmann syndrome is defect at which level? Defect is at pituitary level. Here it is, pituitary. Okay. So here isolated gonadotrophin deficiency. It is pituitary defect, Kallmann syndrome. Anosmia associated with low gonadotrophins. It is pituitary defect level. So, it is, what are all the other things it is associated? Other than anosmia, It is associated with hypothyroidism, mumps, encephalitis, kernicterus and thalassemia major because of iron deposits in the pituitary. So, and retinitis pigmentosa. So, other than anosmia, these are all other features what we see in helminths. It is because of isolated gonadotrophin deficiency. So, this is the first case scenario. Now, tell me if the question asks the breast is absent, uterus is present. So, what are all the causes? RH? Breast is absent, uterus is present. I have asked different, not this. Okay. Breast is absent. I have asked breast absent, not breast present. Breast is absent, uterus is present. Breast is absent means no estrogen. Which conditions we see? What all types of gonadodysgenesis? Turner's, Swears, pure gonadal dysgenesis. Next, what we have discussed, one more. 17 alpha hydroxylase deficiency. Next, Kallmann syndrome. Next, defect at the level of hypothalamus. Okay, so these are all the causes. So, estrogen is not produced. So, if the question says, the second question, scenario is reverse here. Patient is having breast, but uterus is not there. What is that? Patient will be having development of breast. That's what this was the case scenario I was telling you. Previous question I have asked you also. A tall, young female, no pubic hair, no axillary hair, breast development is there, very beautiful. So she will get married to a very, automatically she will get married. So once after marriage, they will come to know that the female is not female, that female is male. The clinical scenario, this is the typical clinical scenario. It is called as androgen insensitivity syndrome, otherwise called as testicular feminization syndrome. So, what is happening in the androgen insensitivity? There are two syndromes. So, suppose if the patient presents with breast present, uterus absent, other than this, what is the cause? If the question says breast present, so breast development is there, but there is no uterus. So, one diagnosis I told you, one cause is androgen insensitivity. What is the second cause? Why the uterus is not developed? Mullerian defect. So, Mullerian agencies, only two causes. So, if there is no uterus means it should be androgen insensitivity or Mullerian agencies. So, we will see what is happening in the androgen insensitivity syndrome. So, normally what is happening? So, what features now I told you, you tell me. So, karyotypically, phenotypically androgen insensitivity syndrome, she will be male or female? Female. So, she will look like a beautiful female. What is happening to axillary hair and pubic hair? Scanty or absent. So, internal genitalia will be? Internal genitalia will be? Absent. Male or female? Internal genitalia. So, outside she will appear like a beautiful female. But she will not become pregnant. Once she goes for investigation, it is male, not female. So, internal genitalia will be male. So, internally she will be, it will be male, but phenotypically when we look outside it is female. So, now we will look what are all the features, why it is developing as, though inside it is male, why it is developed, she is developing as female. So, it is main, the defect is at the level of receptors. So, there are no androgen receptors. So, even though normally what is going to happen for the testes and all to develop, normally androgen receptors should be there. Okay, this testis should act on even further male organs also. So, for that development, normally androgen receptors will work. So, even though the male organs are there, even though the testis and all is there, the testis is producing testosterone androgens, but it is not acting peripherally. Okay, it is not acting peripherally. Why it is not acting peripherally? Because there is defect at the level of receptors. So, normally at the once the patient baby is born, normal male characters will be there, normal male testis and all is inside, but once this testis is there, but it is not acting peripherally, the testosterone for development of male characters, it is defect at the level of androgen receptors. So, the karyotype, so we know karyotype will be male, normally the baby is born as male with testis inside, but there is no receptor, so androgen is not going to work. So, absence of this androgen receptors, automatically she will develop into a female. So, there will be normal functioning male gonads. So, normal testosterone and dihydroepiandrosterone, everything will be there. So, now normally for a female, for a fetus to develop, which hormone it will decide? Either a baby to develop as male or female? No, not testosterone. Anti-Mullerian hormone. So for a fetus to develop either as male or female, it is the anti-Mullerian hormone. So normally the development of female organ is from which duct? Paramesonephric duct or Mullerian duct. So this is female. Male is from Wolfian duct, otherwise called as mesonephric duct, otherwise called as Wolfian duct. This is male. So normally the Mullerian ducts are seen in female. Females are males. So the Mullerian ducts are seen in females. So normally in a male, while the fetus is developing, both will be there. But the anti-Mullerian hormone will decide, okay, either to develop into a male fetus or female fetus. So which decides the anti-Mullerian hormone? So anti-Mullerian deciding either male or female. So which is deciding anti-Mullerian hormone? Which is deciding the anti-Mullerian hormone? So this is the boss is here. So which some boss is sitting above anti-Mullerian hormone. What is the boss? Yeah, correct. Sex determining region of the Y chromosome. So the Y chromosome, there is sex determining region. So that region directs the anti-Mullerian hormone. So the anti-Mullerian hormone normally what it is going to do? Mullerian ducts means female. So they will regress. Anti-Mullerian means it is against the Mullerian duct development. So anti-Mullerian hormone, it will regress the female. Further the organ develops into a male. So this is what going to happening. So Wolfian ducts do not develop. Wolfian is seen in male because they are not stimulated by the testosterone. Here, whatever the other genitalia, external genitalia, why it is not developing? Because it should be stimulated by the testosterone. But even though the testosterone is produced, there are no peripheral receptors. So no further development of the peripheral external genitalia. So how normal female appears as a normal female external genitalia? Because no testosterone for the scrotum and all to develop, for male external genitalia to develop, it needs testosterone along with its receptors. So no testosterone, no male. Finally, the baby will develop into a female to look externally. But internally, there are two gonads, testes, which are secreting the testosterone. So normally, they have either a short or absent vagina. To appear, they will be having a short or absent vagina. They have normal breast, scant or absent axillary and pubic hair. And intra-abdominal testes, which is very important. So it is testes will be in the intra-abdominal. So there will not be further descent of the testes. And very dangerous thing is they are going to cause dysgerminoma or gonadoblastoma. So we need to remove off this testes. So malignancy is very high in such a patients. So this is the typical androgen insensitivity. So the breast development is there. No axillary hair, no pubic hair. It appears like a female external genitalia. But inside we see these are two testes spots. Intra-abdominal testes are there. So normal breast, no hair, normal looking female, absent uterus and vagina. Uterus vagina can be short or sometimes absent, blind, okay? It is the karyotype is 46XY. So initially the baby started as male, but she cannot fully develop, he cannot fully develop into male because of androgen receptors. Finally, externally it will be female, internally it will be male. So treatment, already she will be read as female because of breast development and external genitalia. But later after marriage only she comes, no, it is male. So what to do now? Remove the gonads and create a blind vagina pouch and give her estrogen and progesterone. Okay, that is how. Gonadectomy after puberty and hormone replacement therapy. Is it clear? Androgen insensitivity syndrome. Any doubts? We are going to second. That is, so treatment is estrogen is then given. So normally rated as females. Mullerian agencies. So, if the breast is present, the uterus is absent, there are two conditions. One is, well, until now what have we discussed? Androgen insensitivity, otherwise called as testicular feminization. The second syndrome is Meyer-Rokitansky-Kuster-Hauser syndrome. Okay, it is otherwise called Mullerian agenesis. So, what is happening in this Mullerian agenesis? Mullerian is nothing but the duct, which is responsible for the formation of the female genitalia. So there is defect at the level of the duct. So the duct is not developed. So no duct development, defect at the duct development, defect at the development of the uterus and the vagina. So this is so simple. So absent vagina and non-functioning uterus. There can be sometimes blind vagina or absent vagina. So in both these conditions, it is not totally absent. Sometimes it can be either blind, okay, small short vagina, or totally it can be absent vagina. So and the uterus is non-functioning. Whereas the ovaries, does ovaries develop from Mullerian duct? Which organs are developing? Mullerian agencies. So Mullerian duct is affected. So which organs are affected? Total, tell me, starting first initially for Mullerian duct, what will develop? Fallopian tubes. Next, upper part of the vagina. Okay, this and all will not be there in these patients because of Mullerian agencies. So is ovaries developing from this? No, so ovaries will not be affected. So there will be normal ovulating ovaries. So normal estrogen is released. So what is going to happen to breast? Secondary sexual characters will be there. So normal breast, normal axillary and pubic hair. But these patients, remember, they are associated with urogenital defects. Mullerian agencies will not occur as single. Anywhere the Mullerian defect is associated with urogenital defect. Because even the anteriorly, the bladder, the kidneys and all are associated with this development. Okay. So there will be associated urogenital defect. Should be screened with an ultrasound. So once the patient comes like this, screen her with ultrasound. Ultrasound, there will be absent uterus. Norm, they need supplemental hormones. What is the treatment for this patient? Does they need supplemental hormones? Already estrogen is there. There is no need to supply estrogen in such a kind of patients. Now what to do? There is blind vagina. What do you do? You will create artificially the vagina. How do you create artificial? Can you create artificially uterus? Until now, no one has discovered the artificial uterus at present. We don't know in future. But artificially, we can create vagina. That is called as? They appear as male or female? Normal estrogen, normal breast, normal axillary hair, pubic hair. So, they appear as females. But important thing is, they will not have any children because of absent uterus. But they can have an intercourse due to artificial vagina. We are going to create an artificial vagina. So, they can get married and they can have an intercourse. So, what is the surgery called as? Creating an artificial vagina is called as? Vaginoplasty. So, when do you want to do a vaginoplasty? Just before marriage. So, you create a vagina just before marriage. Why not early, too early or too late? Why not too early? So, once you create an artificial vagina, automatically it will close off fibrosis. So, just before marriage, you create a vagina, you put a vaginal mold. So, after vaginal mold, once they have a coitus or intercourse, automatically, whatever the gap or vaginal pouch we have created, it is maintained. Okay? Or else, throughout the life, patient has to use vaginal mold. Is it clear? Why only just before marriage? So, Mullerian agencies, the caudal portion of Mullerian, they fail to fuse. So, treatment is surgical reconstruction of the vagina. Later followed by vaginal dilators. So that we can create an artificial vagina. So, we will see what is the in-between common. Now, tell me, androgen in insensitivity syndrome, first thing, Mullerian agencies. What is karyotype? Don't look at the chart. Tell me, what is in androgen insensitivity, first thing, what is the karyotype? XY. So, the baby is born as male, but no receptors. So, further read as female. Whereas, Mullerian agencies? XX, she is totally female. Next, breast, what is going to happen to breast in first case? Breast present or absent? Beautiful female, so breast present. Second case, Mullerian agencies? Present. Next, uterus, first case? Androgen insensitivity syndrome. Whereas second case? Both cases, there is no uterus. That's why breast present, uterus absent. Okay, next, coming to pubic or axillary hair, first case? Absent. Okay, whereas second case? Normal estrogen levels. Testosterone, first case. Testosterone levels, normal. There is defected receptor, but testosterone is there. It is producing testosterone. Second case, it is predominant hormone is estrogen. So, second case, it is the estrogen. So, testosterone levels, normal male levels there. Here we see normal female levels. Coming to what is the treatment of first case? Androgen insensitivity. Read as male or female, you want to convert into male or female? Female. So, what do you do? Whatever the gonads are there? gonadectomy, remove that gonads, then replace by hormone. Second case, you want to give hormones? Already hormones are there, no use. What you want to do? Vaginoplasty.